In 1997, the US National Institute of Standards and Technology announced that they were looking for an encryption algorithm to become the Advanced Encryption Standard, or AES. Cryptographers from around the world were invited to submit proposals for the new standard. 15 algorithms were submitted for consideration, and they became the subject of multiple years of debate and research and analysis. Some algorithms were deemed not secure enough, or not performant enough to become the AES. At the end of the process, one algorithm, Raindoll, won the competition and was selected to become the standard. Today, AES is everywhere. It encrypts hard drives, it secures internet communication, and many processors on computers and phones and other devices come with built-in instructions for running AES efficiently. But how does AES work? And what makes for a good encryption algorithm? That's what we're going to explore here, but first, let's start with the basics. When we talk about encryption, what we want is to take some information, called the plain text, and use a secret key to convert it into ciphertext. The ciphertext should ideally be encoded in such a way that someone would need to have that key in order to translate the ciphertext back into the plain text. When working with computers, the plain text, ciphertext, and key can all be thought of as sequences of bits, all just zeros and ones. So, what could this encryption look like? Let's take some plain text, some sequence of bits, and let's create a randomly generated key, some secret sequence of bits that for now we'll assume is the same length as the plain text. How could we come up with an algorithm that encrypts this plain text? Well, we need some way to transform the plain text by using the key. Here's a simple algorithm we could try. For each bit of the plain text, we'll look at the key bit in the same position and make a decision. If the key bit is a 1, that means flip the bit in the plain text. So a plain text 1 would become a ciphertext 0, and a plain text 0 would become a ciphertext 1. And if the key bit is 0, that means leave the plain text bit alone. A plain text 1 stays a 1 in the ciphertext, a plain text 0 stays a 0. If you're familiar with Boolean logic, you might recognize the operation we're performing here as the exclusive OR operation. And the result of applying this bitwise exclusive OR is that we get an encrypted ciphertext. This is a perfectly secure encryption algorithm. If an adversary were to see just the ciphertext, it wouldn't give them any information about the contents of the original plain text. But there's a potential major problem with this approach. The security breaks down if we ever use the same key more than once. If we reuse the key, then it becomes possible for an adversary to gain information. Think of it this way. When the key is used, we combine each bit of plain text with a bit of the key to get a ciphertext bit. So if two ciphertexts have the same bit in the same position, then their plain text bit in that position must be the same too. And that can be enough information to perform some statistical analysis to guess at what parts of the original data might be. So for this algorithm to be secure, we can only ever use the key once, which is why this approach is known as the one-time pad. But if the data we're trying to encrypt is longer than our key, or we want to use our key to encrypt multiple pieces of data, then we need a different approach. So, what properties are we looking for in a good cipher? Two important properties to think about were originally defined by computer scientist Claude Shannon in the 1940s. He described the properties of confusion and diffusion. Confusion is all about complicating the relationship between the key and the resulting ciphertext. In the exclusive OR cipher we were using before, the relationship between each key bit and each ciphertext bit is fairly obvious. Changing a bit in the key results in a change in the same position in the ciphertext. But ideally, a cipher with confusion will ensure that each bit of the ciphertext depends on many bits in the key, so that the relationship is harder to analyze. Diffusion is all about spreading out the statistical structure of the plain text. Plain text messages have statistical patterns. In English, for example, letters vary in how frequently they appear, and some words are more popular than other words. If those patterns were to appear in the ciphertext too, an adversary could analyze those patterns to gain information. So to make our cipher secure, information in the plain text needs to be spread out evenly across the ciphertext. In practice, that means a cipher with diffusion should work such that changing any one bit in the plain text results in a change to about half of the bits in the ciphertext. But our exclusive OR cipher doesn't do that. Notice that when one bit of the plain text changes, only one bit of the ciphertext changes. A good cipher should have both confusion and diffusion. So let's turn our attention back to AES, the Advanced Encryption Standard, to see how its design achieves these goals. AES is what's known as a block cipher, which means it takes a plain text block of a fixed number of bits and produces a ciphertext block of the same size. AES uses a block size of 128 bits, or 16 bytes. So we start with 16 bytes of data that we want to encrypt. AES lays out these bytes in a 4x4 grid. This is known as the state of the algorithm, and we'll make updates to the state repeatedly until we get our encrypted block. So what do we do to encrypt this block? Well, to go back a step, what would our exclusive OR cipher have looked like here? We'd need a key, and a key that's exactly 16 bytes long. And then we'd apply an exclusive OR operation between each bit of the state and each bit of the key to get the resulting state. We call this process adding the key to the state. Now, how could we try to introduce more confusion into the process? Remember that confusion is all about trying to make the ciphertext depend on multiple parts of the key instead of just one part of the key. So here's an idea. Let's take our original key and expand it into multiple keys. There's lots of ways we could do this expansion, but AES specifies a particular process that involves starting with the original key and then determining the other bytes in the expanded key by combining values from particular previous bytes. At particular intervals, the process will add in some constant value or shift the bytes around or swap bytes for other bytes. The goal is to get an expanded set of keys where the bits of the expansion depend on many or all of the bits from the original key. And once we have that expanded key, we can use it on our data. Rather than just adding one key, we'll apply multiple rounds of transformation, where in each round, we'll add a different round key. If you stop to think about it though, adding many round keys in sequence isn't actually any more secure than just adding a single round key. After all, adding many round keys is the same thing as just adding one key that is the result of adding together all of the keys. But the idea of applying multiple rounds of transformation can become helpful if we start to add other steps into the process. What other techniques from cryptography could we use here? One simple type of cipher is the substitution cipher. In a substitution cipher, we transform data by following a defined pattern to replace units of data with other units of data. A simple cipher for working with letters of the alphabet, for example, might replace the letter A with B, the letter B with C, and so on. So a message like H-E-L-L-O becomes I-F-M-M-P. Of course, a substitution that's just a linear shift of all of the letters by a fixed amount is fairly easy to analyze and break. So a better substitution would avoid such a simple relationship. AES uses a substitution step 2, called SubBytes. Instead of substituting letters for other letters, each byte in the state is substituted for a different byte. The encryption algorithm defines exactly what substitution to perform for each byte. 0 gets replaced by 99, 1 gets replaced by 124, 2 gets replaced by 119, and so on, with a different substitution for every byte value. So when AES substitutes bytes, it goes through each byte in the state and replaces it with its appropriate substitution. Just like with our letters, where we wanted to avoid choosing a simple relationship for the substitution, the AES substitution was chosen to be an algebraically complex expression, and one that isn't just a linear transformation of the bytes. That said, even though the substitution is complex, it's public knowledge and known in advance. So AES couldn't rely only on this substitution, since anyone can reverse the subbyte step and get back the original data. Instead, we interleave byte substitution and the round key addition step. Something like this. We take the input state and start by adding an initial round key. Then we repeat some number of rounds, and in each round, we perform a byte substitution and then add the next round key. Only adding round keys one after another doesn't do much for security. Only substituting bytes doesn't do much for security either. But integrating these two steps together results in more confusion. Each bit of the ciphertext depends on multiple parts of the original key by virtue of our key expansion, and it's not immediately obvious how to reverse the encryption without having access to the key. So what's missing from our algorithm now? Recall that in addition to confusion, we also want our algorithm to provide diffusion, spreading out information from the plaintext in the ciphertext. When we change a single plaintext bit, we want many, ideally about half, of the ciphertext bits to change too. But our algorithm right now doesn't do this. When we change a plaintext bit, it might result in changes to the encrypted version of that byte, but it's not going to have an impact on the other bytes in the state. So AES needs some way to introduce diffusion by spreading out information from bytes to other bytes, and ideally add even more confusion to the algorithm in the process. There are two operations AES uses to achieve this, called ShiftRows and MixColumns. Let's actually start by taking a look at the MixColumns step to see what it does. The role of the MixColumns step is to mix together the values contained in each column, essentially diffusing information throughout the values. It operates independently on each column. For each column, MixColumns defines a particular expression for how to combine the four bytes in order to get a new value for each byte. Each new value in the column therefore depends on all of the previous values in the column. It's worth pointing out here that we're using multiplication and addition symbols, but we're not quite performing the normal multiplication and addition you might be used to. If we did use normal multiplication and addition, we might end up getting values larger than what could be stored in a single byte. Instead, these multiplication and addition operations have to work with only a finite number of possible values, the 256 possible values for a single byte. Since there are only a finite number of possible values, this is known as finite field arithmetic. So the MixColumns step successfully spreads out information throughout the columns. But so far, no information moves between the columns throughout the whole algorithm. That's where the earlier ShiftRows step comes in. This step shifts the values in each row by a different amount. The first row is left unchanged, the second row gets shifted by 1, the third row shifted by 2, and the fourth row shifted by 3. These two operations combined, ShiftRows and MixColumns, help to mix together the values from the state, and even more so when these steps get repeated across multiple rounds. So with all of these operations in mind, we can now describe AES in full. We start with some data, and a key we want to use for encryption. We start with a key expansion step that takes the key and expands it into many round keys, each of which depends on the values from the original key. We then add in the first round key. Now comes the round itself. In each round, we start by applying subbytes, substituting each byte for its replacement. Then we shift rows, shifting each row by a different amount. Then we mix columns, combining the values from each column to get new column values. And then at the end of each round, we add round key one more time. This process repeats for each round until we get our final encrypted result. It turns out that the mix column step is actually skipped for the very last round only, and that doesn't change the security of the algorithm. How many rounds of transformation does the algorithm use? That depends on the size of the original key. AES is designed to work with multiple key sizes, 128-bit keys, 192-bit keys, and 256-bit keys. Each key size is associated with a different number of expanded keys, and therefore a different number of rounds. And if you've ever heard the terms AES 128, AES 192, or AES 256, that's what the numbers refer to, the size of the key. The larger the key, the more difficult it is to attack by brute force. There's a lot going on in AES. Substitutions, shifting values, mixing values, adding keys. But each step contributes to the security of the overall cipher, to form an algorithm secure enough to be used to encrypt data every day all across the world. And there's other details we haven't covered yet, like how to take this algorithm and apply it to sequences of data longer than a single block. But hopefully this gives you some insight into the inner workings of the algorithm itself, and an appreciation for some of the ideas behind what makes a cipher secure.